So I'm James Bourne. I'm head of display for Jellyfish. So I'm the local here, I suppose, in one sense. But I head up all of our display, US, UK, globally. But the thing that we do is we put programmatic first. So we're a programmatic first display company. And that's pretty much, that's me in a nutshell, really.
Hi, I'm Alana Tominski. I work at the Mail Online and I look after a number of programmatic account managers that rep all the main agency trading desks all in the UK.
Good afternoon. My name's Gavin Owen. I'm head of digital at Nestle UK and Ireland. My role is to work with our brand managers on a day-to-day basis, putting the foundations in place for digital, and then on an elevator role, really looking at programmatic and how it fits into our business to drive market share and eliminate waste.
Great, thanks. So can I just have a quick show of hands? Who in the room is actually currently running or has done a programmatic display campaign? So hardly any of you. Okay, so that I guess that kind of shows how new the technology is and what the uptake's been like. And obviously, hopefully, it will increase. But I think a really good question to start is to kind of strip it right back. And if you could each kind of just tell the audience, what is programmatic, you know, in, without using the sort of dictionary definition, I guess. James, do you want to start?
Happy to. It's difficult. Anybody that knows me knows that I struggle to be concise at the best of times. And trying to describe what is really a whole technology, it's the replacement for the advertising ecosystem. As by the nervous system, it's very difficult to put into a few words, but really it's our ability to select what we want to buy on your behalf. So I'm the media buyer, effectively. So it's our ability to decision and buy exactly what we want for our advertisers' campaigns. It's our ability to merge data, whether that's from other people, whether that's from publishers ourselves, whether that's from your own CRM systems or your own site data, or context, and merge that together to deliver a superb campaign, which goes across screens and across formats as well. So that's it in a nutshell for me, I think. Then in 5 minutes' time, I'll have a whole heap of other things that I'd like to define programmatic as.
I think from a publisher perspective, I think what programmatic has actually done is allowed us to utilise our data basically so that we can give that out to our advertisers so that we can deliver them the right audiences at the right time and probably within the right context. And as Gavin's already mentioned, it does sort of minimise wastage. When you're running like a direct campaign, especially across display, it's like, here's a chunk of money and we're just going to run it across our site. And if you pick up the right audience, then you're quite lucky. But what programmatic allows you to do is make sure that every impression you're delivering is going in front of the right person.
I think they've both summed it up exceptionally well. It's bringing very good technology with super smart individuals, apart from James, who's just average. I'm bringing super smart people within James's team and across.
That's a fair comment.
And it's using data and using media to really drive efficiency. And I always use the word eliminating waste. At the end of the day, we've got a lady here from SMA, baby product. She doesn't want to advertise to 65-year-old men. You know, they're not in the market for a baby. So we just eliminate those people from our media buying. And it just generates fantastic results.
Yeah, it does. And this is the one thing, because programmatic, I mean, I agree with Dara, we're in it now, we're well in it. It's even if you don't know that we are, if your agency may be running campaigns programmatically for you about your total knowledge, that's a good thing. But the one thing that we've overlooked, we've always talked about positive targeting, but Gavin's right, eliminating waste is super important. And if you think, one of my bugbears with sort of the industry, particularly I'm a digital boy, I always have been, I'm first and foremost, but we don't always take learnings from the other parts of advertising and marketing. And if you look at our direct mail cousins, how brilliant they are with lists and suppression of making sure that they don't advertise to people that they already know. Programmatic starts and allows us to do that as well. So we can look at your current customer base, we can recognise them, change the message if we need to tell them something, or keep those acquisition-focused advertisements away from them, which means that we become more efficient, that's a wonderful thing in itself. There's a reason to do it. Everything can be done there. That's it. Yeah, it's good.
Great. Thanks, James. And I think it'd be really good for the audience to understand, if you take, for example, the Dolce Gusto campaign going, how the three of you work together on that campaign to kind of get success.
So I'll start. So I'm Nestle. I've got this pot of money. I want to acquire customers for the Dolce Gusto coffee machine. We have very particular custom audience segmentation. We know who we want to go after. We know that we sell 80% of the machines in the last quarter of the year. So we decided to really break the rule books. And I said, okay, let's actually buy this programmatically. Let's actually, just like the Kellogg's example, let's optimize the viewability. At the end of the day, we can't drive market share if our adverts aren't seen. So let's actually use that smart technology, using the data to bring new customers into our website. And ultimately, I'll be honest with you, it's cheaper to buy the machines on Amazon than our website. So please don't buy Dolce Gusto on our website, go and buy it on Amazon. But this is all about awareness. We're not interested in actually selling the machines. We're interested then in then moving on to the actual product acquisition.
Yeah, precisely. And I was just thinking back to what Darrow was saying, and it's very true. And I've said this time and time again, and programmatic started with RTB, really, real-time bidding, which is just basically an auction fest. And the first people, when something new comes along in digital, invariably to get stuck in and find out if this works are the pornographers and the gamblers. And then shortly behind them, it's the hardcore direct response advertisers. And RTB kind of got this name, it kind of got a bad reputation for just buying inventory at the lowest price that you possibly can, which obviously really annoyed Alana, and didn't really do us any favours. But now we're progressing beyond that. And as Darrow also quite rightly mentioned, we get premium quality inventory that we can start to buy. So it's not a case of always flogging machines in Gavin's case. It is an awareness tool, it's a brand marketer's tool as much as a direct response tool. Because what comms planner on the planet, what advertiser does not want awareness level to almost have a one-to-one dialogue with your users to be able to target in that way? And that's what programmatic, that's what it enables and that's what it brings. So it's not just a cheap medium, is it? No,
I think James is right. Actually, like RTB is what started replacing like all the old network buys. So back in the day, it was a network model. It's like, how cheap can you get your advertising away? And RTB kind of took over from that and knocked the networks out of business. But as both these guys have mentioned, it is a brand marketing tool. And the good thing for us is actually now where we've put our data management platform in place, it means that we can track at the Mail Online across our properties over 6,000 data points in real time. So we've got a real insight into who our audience are from like a demographic point of view and also from a behaviour point of view. And we can now apply those to like sort of our big brand formats, so whether that be a takeover on the homepage or whether that be a bit of native editorial content. And we can actually feed all those behaviours and actions out into the programmatic space and allow those audiences to be bought programmatically, which offers basically your customers an end-to-end solution. Whereas before, you've got your RTB rat race that could be running alongside what you're doing on a direct basis, which causes a massive amount of overlap. And again, it's probably targeting all the wrong people. And as Darrow's already mentioned again and again, after they've already bought a product.
I think a really good example of this to bring to life, Nestle's on record, me. I will pay more for my inventory than anyone else in the market. Fact, I want to pay top price and I empower my agencies to buy the very best inventory. Because when you take good quality inventory with data, the actual cost per view, the actual metric which we're driving to actually drives significantly more efficiency. So if you take Purina dog, 20% of UK households own a dog. Now, I have no interest to advertise to 80% of the UK audience. So if I go to a publisher like the Daily Mail and I say, okay, I want to match data with big formats, but I only want to target people with dogs, straight away, I can actually pay five times more for the individual bid impression than I would before. Naturally, we'll only pay maybe twice or 2.5 times more. But straight away, while someone thinks I'm crazy for saying I want to pay more for the inventory, I'm actually driving efficiencies because I'm only having one-on-one conversations with people who actually own a dog.
Yeah, it's true. I borrow somebody's phrase. I can't remember who coined this. So I've blatantly stolen it. But programmatic is kind of, if you embrace the idea of buying less but paying more, that's the way to do it. Don't think of it as, okay, this is one way that I can flood the whole marketplace with really cheap impressions. You can do that. If you want, we can help you. But you'll get far more out of it by being razor sharp with your targeting. And also, it's the way that we deliver campaigns. It's the way that we think about it. And as Alana was saying, you know, if you buy, even if you buy targeted inventory on a lot of publishers, if you buy the sports section, for example, you get, yeah, all of the ad spaces on the sports section if you want, but still a big chunk of those people are either maybe your customers already know your brand, or just aren't relevant or interested. So it's just being able to drill down maybe that one step further in terms of the targeting. And there's real value in doing that, which is why we're seeing the growth rate of this buying methodology accelerate like it does.
Yeah, and I probably shouldn't say this because I am a salesperson and it's all about bringing the money in, but if a campaign isn't working, from the buyer side point of view, you can switch it off instantly. You can, if it's working, you can ramp your spend up instantly. It's not a case of you don't have to allocate specific budget to a specific site. You're allocating that budget to an audience, and that money will spend where that audience is, regardless of the site that it's sat on.
There's a kind of subtext here, which is why there's the three of us sitting here, which is programmatic kind of opens doors and it breeds transparency, or it forces transparency if you're smart enough with your buying and if you're a smart enough client. Because it would be pretty rare in digital advertising to have the client, the advertiser basically, the media agency and a publisher sitting up here talking to you as one. But we all now share that data. We all are quite open in what we do. In fact, at Jellyfish, we insist on it. We won't buy anything unless we know exactly what it is in display, which actually serves a really nice purpose as well. It kind of cleans up the internet. The network model of buying it as cheap as we can, as much as we can to fulfill our goals, kind of also ruined the internet, because publishers were forced to put more and more adverts on the page to keep their revenues at where they needed to be, to keep on creating content, to keep on giving you things like the Mail or whatever publication you happen to be reading. And that means the effectiveness of all advertising starts to deteriorate and go downhill. Back to the whole, maybe, you know, buy less, pay more. If you start to take those crap adverts, those crap placements off of pages, the effectiveness of your campaigns as a whole go up. Gavin gets better performance, better messaging, everything that we've talked about. Alana's yields go up because we're happy to pay more for it, because actually we're good, we get an understanding client that gets that, but we can see the value and it all backs out right. And what Dara was saying, you know, viewability, that's a powerful metric for us. I mean, it's really, really quite obvious when you think about it, isn't it? If more people see your adverts, they're going to be more effective, or you'd hope so. And if that's not the case...
Does anyone here want to buy unsold in, you know, inventory that not seen? Is there anyone here who just wants to buy non-viewable impressions? Probably not. So I think it's really fair to ask, can my adverts be seen? And a really good idea of collaboration, and this really puts it true, in Nestle will pay more for their inventory. About 3 weeks ago, Amanda Holden was featured Mail Online. Just naturally was speaking about one of our products, Cetaphil hand cream. At Nestle, I'm blessed with working flexible working hours, so I normally start about 6 in the morning and finish about 2:30 in the afternoon. So I was on the Daily Mail at 6, and I noticed Amanda Holden was talking about one of our products. In collaboration with my agency, I immediately emailed the Daily Mail. I said, I want the inventory on the Amanda Holden story today. Can I buy it programmatically? The guy at the Daily Mail was then, as soon as he got in the office at 8 o'clock, he was running around the office telling everyone in the office, you are not selling that inventory today. Nestle wants this programmatically. From a yield management perspective, Nestle are going to pay more for it. The nutshell, what we got was 9 times higher click-through rate. It was an e-commerce campaign. We couldn't actually fulfill all the orders. We had to then send the traffic off to Amazon. And our viewability was only 64%. And the agency called me and they said, Gavin, we're really sorry, viewability was only 64%. But the ad appeared below the fold. So actually, 64% really showed a highly engaged audience, because people don't go to websites to look at my adverts. But it's a really, really good way of working in collaboration with the agency, where we spotted something, we can then directly contact the publisher, then the agency took over the optimization. But literally, one of the first times, as the Daily Mail, we're literally stripping adverts out from a yield optimization perspective.
Yeah, we do, don't we? We operate, we have different conversations now with publishers, particularly because we know when we want to buy impressions. We know exactly who we want. So it's more of a case of not getting to the end of a campaign and going, yeah, that worked. Oh, that didn't. Right, next time we won't do any of that. It's looking at it in real time. And the conversations I'm likely to have with people like Alana and Awish, saying, actually, we're not quite getting as much traffic. We're not getting as much impressions that we'd like out of this. we can see we have to deny because we've got a lot of these people are actually customers. Is there a data segment that you've got that will open up our targeting a little bit and allow us to find more new users? And it's almost, those conversations never existed in ad buying before. You know, it's we're being smarter, I think. It's definitely a good thing.
I think an interesting thing is the integration. It's not just, you know, we're talking about programmatic, but our programmatic links into our TV buying strategy. It links into our paid search. As James said, it links into our CRM. It really becomes an integrated linchpin. And I was actually talking to one of the guys at Jellyfish earlier on today in regards to our Dolce Gusto campaign. And we very much link our paid search and the programmatic, but then we use the Google Analytics in the background to really start to drive those extra efficiencies. And I think programmatic is, yes, it's using technology, but it comes down to the talent. It comes down to the actual, you know, paid search is very much about the experts running paid search. Programmatic is exactly the same. You might think you have good programmatic campaigns today, but really start to dig in and really look at what your KPIs are, because we can always eke additional efficiency. But I would urge each and every one of you out there is to actually pay your agencies a fair fee, because talent in programmatic is not cheap. Data scientists, £80,000 plus, you know, and that's an entry level data scientist. You know, this industry is new, and that's why it does come with the fees, but you do actually eke out the efficiencies.
And I think as well, like, people are scared of programmatic. It comes with millions and millions of acronyms and buzzwords and data and real time, and it does sound quite complicated, but actually you've got an agency and a publisher that will do everything for you, that will do the hard work. They actually make it very, very easy for you guys to put money into the programmatic space and actually not worry too much about how you're actually going to do it, because they're sort of from our side of the fence, we will be doing it for you. And as a publisher, we're very transparent. So if we say to you we're targeting 18 to 35 males that want a credit card, for example, we will show you exactly how we've built that audience out and what it is made up of.
Alana, sorry, James, but leading on from that, No, not at all. But it actually leads on. So this is a room full of kind of people at the forefront of digital, but when I asked the question at the beginning, probably under 5% of people put their hand up as to you know, whether or not they're using programmatic. So leading on from that, guys, what do you think are the key reasons why, what is impeding the take-up, I guess, is the question. Like, Gavin, for example, you said that within Nestle, big brand, huge amounts of spend online, but you had a real challenge trying to change the mindset internally to go programmatic. So just interested to know.
For any brand here today, I'll make you an offer. I'll come and spend an hour in my own time, and I'll come and talk to you about programmatic, how it can potentially be integrated into your wider media strategy. The skills, the understanding of programmatic on client side is still exceptionally limited at this time. A lot of very senior marketeers don't understand it, and they're actually scared to hire smart people into their organization, because programmatic is going to be the future. We're all here today, we're all talking about it, so we need to grasp it. But I will repeat that. I will give anyone in this room an hour of my time to talk about programmatic and how it could potentially work within your business. You know, I've already spoken to insurance clients. You know, I just speak to people across the entire sector, because personally I believe that programmatic is the future, because it's not just display, it's not just video. Television is going to be, it's already in America being traded programmatically. So the businesses, you need to start to put those skills, but the actual operational side has to sit with, in my opinion, it has to sit with the agencies.
Yeah, it's true, because actually one of the things that maybe impedes growth about programmatic is the fact that there's still quite a lot of smoke and mirrors that go around with it. Stuff isn't hidden behind acronyms necessarily, but we're talking about advertising moving on from the ad network model. Those guys are in, you know, some of them are, a lot of them are in serious trouble because they didn't do anything more than just broker inventory and put a margin on it. They don't want to lose that business model. So they're sometimes putting a lot of smoke and mirrors around programmatic to make it seem a little bit more inaccessible than it kind of really is. But there's one key thing as well. When you can get your hands on all of the inventory in one place, in one platform, that integration, if you start running lots of bits of it, you're kind of fragmenting, you're going to create that overlap that existed within ad networks, okay? Unless you're very smart. So the key thing is have it centralized, have a key strategy that sits with either one agency, one person within your brand, or something like that, so you can make sure that you're managing it effectively. Just keep your eyes on it, it'll be fine.
You'd be surprised, actually, there are some agencies that do lack knowledge in programmatic. So one thing we're doing is we're going out with presentations around actually making programmatic easy. And we've got a team of 20 at the Mail that work across programmatic. So we've got guys that work with all the technology platforms. We've got a data engineer. You've got a full sales team. And we've got quite a lot of different kind of skill sets. So something we're trying to do is actually go out and educate people within the agencies as well, because they're being pushed to plan programmatically now as well.
Thanks to Alana, Gavin and James.